But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, He saved us, not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to His own mercy, by the washing of the regeneration and renewal through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that being justified by grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Dear church, please be seated. One of the most important events in European history, as some of you are aware, is the Renaissance. It happened 14th to 17th century and acts as the cultural bridge between the Middle Ages and the modern history. It has changed the world upside down in such a way that there were many revolutions in terms of arts and sciences and politically as well. It was here when massive discoveries of lands and continents happened. Many voyages were sent to terra incognita, to the unknown world. It was during this era when it is proven that the earth is round, it's not flat. Other events in terms of commerce and invention of powerful innovations that produce paper for printing and compass and gunpowder happened also in this era. From the period of darkness, they have seen many lights through intellectual prowess of humanity. After a great cultural decline and stagnation during the Middle Ages, now they felt that they were new again. They have discovered the value of classical learning from Greeks and writers of old. In fact, Renaissance really means rebirth, being born again. They wanted a new status quo during that time, where the center revolves, of course, that time it's more about the humanistic movement. You know, we may not have time to study history. This is not the scope of our topic for tonight, this morning. But it's just proof that humanity, in general, has some notion of rebirth. Starting all over again, to be born again, to a new world or chapter in life. What is more dramatic? What is more revolutionary than the rebirth of cultural interest is rebirth of one person. Being born again spiritually, by which you have become entirely new creation. You are still you physically, but your innermost part has been changed dramatically, drastically, and radically. You have been born again. Now we know that the word born again has very superficial meanings. Some would say that being born again is simply subscribing to the born again religion. Some are Catholic, some are Lutheran, but I am born again. Very superficial. Some would say that being born again means praying the Lord's Prayer or responding to an altar call or asking Jesus to come into your life, whatever that means. Some would say, especially young boys and girls here, they are born again because their parents, their mom and dad are born again. Therefore, I am born again as well. Church, as we listen to the Word of God today, would you challenge yourselves and examine your life if you are indeed born again? And if you claim that you are, does it show in your life? I want you to be sincere to yourself and then call upon the name of the Lord. Let us read the text for this morning as we continue our study in John. John chapter 3, verse 1 to 3. Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do the signs unless God is with him." Jesus answered to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God." We are still continuing a study on the Gospel of John. If you open your Bibles in John chapter 20, verse 21, we can see here that the thesis of John, that the whole aim of the book, the main reason why John has written this book for us believers. We can see here in these verses that John has a twofold aim. It is apologetic and it is an evangelistic letter as well. Those are his main thrusts in writing this letter. So John chapter 20, verse 21, this is written so that you may believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in His name. It is apologetic, verse 21, verse 8. First part, it is defending that the fact is this Jesus, the one that came from Nazareth, the son of Joseph, was indeed the Savior of the world, the long-awaited Messiah that will save His people from their sin. Second, it's also evangelistic in second phrase, that believing you may have life in His name. It's never enough that you know about that Christ, but this letter assures you that when you believe on Him, you will surely and definitely, absolutely have an everlasting life in His presence. In these previous studies, we have gone through as a way of review, we have seen this trust of John's message. We have seen that indeed Jesus Christ is the Messiah. He was not only the son of Joseph, but the Son of God in flesh. He has proven, according to different testimonies by John himself, the apostle, he said, he wrote, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. And the Word, very explicitly said, is God. Verse 1. And not only that, verse 14, he proceeds, not only was He God, the magnificence of His condescension happened in chapter 1, verse 14, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. God, residing in heaven, taking for Himself the nature of man, became man and tabernacled in us, and we have seen His glory, and it's not only as the glory of, as a man, but the glory of God from the Father. In the testimony of John the Baptist, he was proclaimed, He's the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And not only John the Baptist proclaimed that testimony, even his first disciples proclaimed that. He said, John and Andrew said, we have found the Messiah. Philip said, come and see for yourself the one whom Moses and the prophets wrote. We have seen Him. We have found the Christ. And what was Nathanael's response when he saw a glimpse of Jesus' omniscience? Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. And even Christ Himself said, I am the Son of Man who will show forth greater glory than my omniscience. So not only was this testimony of these people proves that Jesus Christ that Jesus is the Messiah. Christ Himself show forth His glory. He has made water into wine. He cleansed the temple. And lastly, last week, we have seen that again He manifested His omniscience, prophesying that He will die. His body or His temple will be destroyed. 3 days, He will rise up again. So indeed, He was the Messiah. Apologetic. We have proven that in such a short chapters in our study. Indeed, He was the Christ, and it's just the beginning of all these evidences that we have indeed the Messiah. We are the second chapter. How blessed are we believers now that we have more abundant proof that indeed Jesus was God and Messiah. We have the whole Bible testifying to that truth. Just a side comment, atheism at their finest is nothing but laziness to devour and search for themselves the truth that they are seeking. Amen. We are sure, we are confident that indeed Christ is the Savior. There is no one else. Now in these passages we can see the evangelistic trust of God, of John's message, of John's gospel. We can see, again, we came here not to rule, Jesus came here not to rule politically, nor to be the greatest philanthropist. No, even His name indicates His mission. Matthew chapter 1, verse 21, you shall call His name Jesus, for He shall save His people from their sin. In chapter 2 of John 2, verse 25 says, He knew what was in man. He knew that the depravity of human heart, and He will expose that to us. There will always be two scenarios, two types of people. one who is self-righteous, and the other one who acknowledged the depravity of their sin. Both of them did the saving work of Christ. Yes. We will, in this preceding chapter 3 and chapter 4, we will see an encounter between two prominent figures and two dialogues with two different persons. And like a surgeon, with the precision of hands and tools, he will cut through the innermost heart, first of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, and the adulterer later on in John chapter 4, the Samaritan woman, to reveal their sin and their need for sin. Oh, church, this morning, may we allow the greatest doctor and surgeon to examine your heart. I call first to those who are not yet converted, to those people who ask, what do you mean born again? What in the world are you talking about? Why do I need the saving? May you examine your heart, please, in this moment. May you consider this great grace being offered to you this day. And I challenge those who say that they are born again. Have you been rejoicing in this truth? Mm-hmm. Have this been the most important milestone in your life that you look back again and again and again to this grace that you were saved and redeemed and regenerated? Every time you remember the grace of our Lord, there is a rejoicing in your heart that for such a great salvation. Mm-hmm. Church, dear friends, may this be our simple message for us this morning. It is God's imperative that you abandon yourself righteousness and be born again through faith in Christ Jesus. It is God's imperative that you abandon your self-righteousness and be born again through faith in Christ Jesus. As we proceed, I will discuss two points to us this morning. First point is the inquiry of the man, Nicodemus. And second point, the imperative of the Messiah. In the inquiry of the man, Nicodemus, imperative of the Messiah. Let's go now and dive into our text. First point, the inquiry of the man, Nicodemus. John chapter 3 verse 1 says, now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher from God, for no one can do these signs unless God is with him. Note here that we have a conjunction now on verse 1. Now, implying that the preceding verses in chapter 2 are connected here in this chapter 3. Verse 25 says, he knew what was in man. And then chapter 3 starts with, now there was a man. John was telling his reader, Christ through his omniscience knew the deepest recesses and innermost chamber of human heart. Maybe some of you would think that there is good enough percentage of goodness in man, enough for him to be saved. But Christ, being the greatest teacher, gave us a living proof of someone who thinks highly of his righteousness and goodness, yet blinded by his own sin. Let's examine this man, therefore Nicodemus, and his inquiry to the Lord. Let's examine and continue. Verse 1a, there was a man of the Pharisee. This man belonged to the group of the Pharisees. It's a religious sect during that time. It came from the word Parisha. It means the separated ones. You know, they thought that they are cut above the rest. Among the common Jews, the reason why they are above everyone else is they thought they are righteous. They knew the law. They have knowledge of the law of the Lord. Their origin can be traced back during the Maccabean War. It was during the time of silence of the Lord, 400 years time of silence and time of Maccabeus. And it was when the Greek dominated the Israel at that time, and there was a cry among Judah that said, we have to preserve the law of the Lord. So this group arose from that scenario. They stressed the importance of the Torah. The Torah is just the law. It's specifically the law, but generally the Old Testament. But in addition to that, they have written other strict laws and interpretation of that law. It's called the Talmud. And this man, the Pharisee, they are the spiritual elite at that time. They thought they have obeyed the law, unlike those ordinary Jews. They knew the law, not only the law, I knew also the Talmud. They wanted to be known to others that they knew something. They have obeyed the law, and such was the hypocritical characteristic of that group. As an example, Luke chapter 18, verse 19 to 14. And Christ has many encounter with them, and these were Christ's words against them. You brood of vipers, you liars, you hypocrites, you blind guys, you fools. Matthew 23, strong words. And John chapter 8, he pronounced a condemnation against them. John chapter 8, you shall die in your sins. Massive words of rebuke from the Lord. Now let's go to this man, Nicodemus. John identified this man as Nicodemus, which when we further study here, is a prominent power in the realm of Judaistic, ecclesiastical, and political arena at that time. John recognized this man, he's very famous, and John said, oh, this is Nicodemus, this man, Nicodemus. It was mentioned in John chapter 7, verse 50 and 1939, and John chapter 19, verse 39, where we can see the effects of his conversation and conversation and conversion with the Messiah. There's a public commentary. Get into that. And we proceed. This man, Nicodemus, is not only a member of the Pharisee, he was also a ruler of the Jews. Gil commands ruler of the Jews, not just a civil magistrate for civil government. He was a member of that Sanhedrin during that time. It was consisted of the doctors and wise men and priests, Levites and Sadducees. These are like the magistrates during that time, the Sanhedrin. And he, Nicodemus, was one of the 70. He was a member of those council. He was a dignified person. And afterwards, he was called later on. It was Jesus Christ himself called him teacher of Israel, master of Israel. Right added, Nicodemus is called a ruler. He was chief person among the Jews. John chapter 3, verse 10, you are teacher of Israel. So here, we are presented with a man with all his credentials, achieved from lifetime of service as a priest, as a Pharisee, as a teacher of the law. He was famous. He was highly esteemed. He was highly popular teacher. Don't you know that the first person awarded by the Time magazine as the person of the year was Charles Lindbergh on 1927. He was commended after his first solo non-stop flight across Atlantic Ocean on May 20 and 21, 1927. This flight was about 33 and a half hour flight. Lindbergh was honored with awards and medals and parades throughout the world. If there was a Time magazine during that time, Nicodemus will certainly be one of those who will be awarded in terms of his righteousness, in terms of his influence. Well, seeking righteousness, I should say. As Jesus would later on point out, the deadness of his spiritual life and the vanity of all his achievements. Let's proceed now to the second verse. This man came to Jesus by night. We can see here Nicodemus' lack of courage from human judgment, especially from his colleagues in the Sanhedrin. He came by night. He saw the signs that Jesus was doing during the Passover. He marveled at those signs and wonders. He observed the crowd. He observed Jesus as he drove out the corrupt money changers and sellers inside the temple. Could this be the Son of God? as he was claiming to be? Could this be the long-awaited Messiah? But I'm a ruler of the Jew. I'm in a dignified position. What will I go to that man? Who's that man? This is just the son of a carpenter. It is embarrassing for me that fishermen like John and Peter understand what the Messiah was talking about. And I was, all my life, I'm reading through the scriptures and I didn't see it.
Yeah.
I shall inquire anyway, but I'm afraid of what my colleague would say of me and my fellow teachers would say of me. I got a plan. I shall go by night. He was afraid. He loved his glory more than the glory of seeing the Shekinah dwelling amidst his people. John chapter 12 verse 42 to emphasize that nevertheless many of even of the authorities believed in him, but for fear of the Jews they did not confess it, so they would not be put out of the synagogue. They were afraid. They were loved. They loved their glory more than seeing the glory of God. Calvin comments, for his eyes were dazzled, as it were, by the splendor of his own greatness and reputation. Perhaps, too, he was hindered by shame, for ambitious men think that their reputation is utterly ruined if they have once descended from the dignity of teachers to the rank of scholars. And he was unquestionably puffed up with a foolish opinion of his knowledge. In short, he had a high opinion of himself. He was unwilling to lose any part of his elevation. Such is the man, the protagonist in our story. Verse 2, second phrase, I came by night and said to him, we know that you are a teacher from God. Teacher, come from God. Here, not only did he lack courage, but he also lacked knowledge of this God. Well, he said, but look at the verse. He said, we know that you are a teacher from God. He said to him, Rabbi, we know. He addressed Christ as Rabbi, coming from a reputed leader and teacher. He acknowledged that Jesus was a teacher like himself. Though he was not a member of the Pharisaical sect and school, he has respect for our Lord. And he said, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher from God. We know, he said. He continued, implying that the Pharisees has been made aware of the great things happening very recently. We know that there was a man who named Jesus who was making noises, performing signs and wonders that they have not seen in a while. We know. We have knowledge. We are Pharisees anyway. That's our main business, to get knowledge. So we know who you are. But the preceding words greatly revealed their lack of knowledge. We know that you are a teacher from God. Verse 2. And indeed, it was true. Jesus Christ is the greatest teacher. He's a master teacher. Indeed, he will expound the law and the prophets. Indeed, he was he knew every Old Testament text by heart. But he is not the great rabbi alone. He is not the great rabbi alone. He is the great I am. He is the Christ. He is the Lion from the tribe of Judah. The Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. He is the Son of Man, full of splendor and glory. That the prophet Daniel saw in his vision. Yes, Nicodemus. You think you, after graduating from your Pharisaical school, you know something? You think in you? But I'm revealing this to you. That I am the Christ. What we know is lacking. It is not enough. It is damning. It will surely deliver you to hell. I am not just your professor. I am the Savior of men. Children, young boys and young girls, I'm speaking to you right now. Maybe some of you know about this Jesus. That Jesus is, that he was from the Bible, that he has fed thousands of people, that he worked miracles. Maybe your mom and dad mentioned his teachings to you, but it is never enough that you know about him. You need to know and acknowledge him as your Savior. If not, then he will cast you into hell. And your mom and your dad will not prevent God from judging you and condemning you. So little children, examine yourself as well during this preaching. Mm-hmm. It is important that you know and you acknowledge him as your Savior. Mm-hmm. Verse 2, we proceed now. No one can do these signs unless God is with him. Not only did he lack courage and knowledge, he also seemingly lacked evidence. He said, you are a teacher from God. You are a teacher from God because you do these miracles. You are doing this, therefore, based on this evidence, that you are, therefore, Son of God. You can perform signs and wonders. Again, we know that God, through his gracious mediation, has provided wonders and signs to authenticate his words. However, it is not abundant during biblical times, should I say. It happened only during Moses' time and the time of the prophet, during Elijah and Elisha particularly. It was also abundant during Jesus and apostles' time. Those were the three era where signs and wonders were concentrated, during Moses' time, during the prophet time, and during the time of our Lord. However, note that the wonders and signs from God is always accompanied by his word, by his teaching, by the proclamation of his law and statutes. The wonders authenticated the word. Let us beware. That's a quick polemical issue that we need to address. We know that God is a miracle-working God. He is a sovereign, powerful, omnipotent God. But we should be careful to those who teach. And their primary means of acquiring audience is through words of signs and wonders. Let us be careful of that. Ryle said, in these times, of men and women can stand up and teach the most erroneous doctrines, yet if they prefer as their credentials the power to perform miracles of healing, they are widely received and hailed as the servants of God. It was true during J.C. Ryle's time, and it's true even today, so let us beware. Instead of signs and wonders, we have now the word of the Lord in Scripture. What you are holding on right now, this word has the power to change you to the work of the Spirit. Sometimes I wish, Lord, that you can do miraculous stuff so I can just open the word and then people will believe. And it's hard for me to speak to you even now I'm prepared. Sometimes I just, Lord, can you do miracle? Can you work wonder? But preaching of the word, the proclamation of his name is the only way by which we know that Christ is our Lord. Christ is our Savior. So we devour everything from this. And we, teachers, we devour everything from this. And we proclaim to you. We preach to you. Yes, Nicodemus, a certain proof. It is lacking. Yes, the Lord works wonders and signs. Yes, the Lord was truly from God because he couldn't do unless otherwise. But Nicodemus did not take heed to the words of the Lord. He saw the wonders, but he neglect the word of the Lord. His proclamation, I am the word, John chapter 1 verse 1, and the word is God. He didn't understand that. Nicodemus, you have seen those things that I performed to you, Christ was saying, but you should have listened to my teachings. I am the Messiah. I am your Lamb that will take away your sin. Salvation is greater and more glorious wonder than any miracles in this world. Amen. Such a man that we encounter here in this verse, completely unaware of his coming destruction. He thought he knew. He thought he has performed everything. He inquired of the Lord, maybe to acknowledge his righteousness before the Holy God. He said to himself, Lord, I am righteous. I'm not. But he was blinded. He was not saved. Maybe right now you're saying, what a poor man he is. Blinded man. What a pity that he has worked all his righteousness for nothing. My friend, you are not in Christ. You are very much like Nicodemus. Your righteousness means nothing. You are coming to against the wrath of God. The destruction will be against you. My point here is this. Your self-righteousness cannot save you. It will not. It cannot save you. Maybe today your soul is being haunted by the reality of the coming judgment. You need saving, my friend. Maybe you thought that I need heaven. I'm scared of this hell. I'm scared of more than that, of this God. But I will work my way so I can be saved. Good works cannot save you. Being good cannot save you. No one is good, not even one. Romans 3:23. All your words are like filthy rags. All become are unclean. Righteous deeds are like polluted garment. All we like sheep have gone astray. Each of us turning our own separate way. Challenge for us is this. A careful examination of our ground for salvation is necessary. A careful examination of your salvation, of the ground, of what basis, of what the reason you are saved is necessary. If good works is your ground, if good works are your ground, my friend, you will find one thing, just like Nicodemus. I beseech you, therefore, I implore you and challenge you, seek Christ's righteousness. Call upon Him, and you shall be saved. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not all of your own doing. It's not because of your works that you have done. It is grace. It is the gift of God as a result. So it's not the result of works, so that no one may boast. Christ's grace, Christ's righteousness. Believe on Him, and you shall be saved. Put your hope not on yourself, but Christ and Christ alone. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus Christ and His righteousness. I dare not trust on sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. Christ, the solid rock, here I stand. The old utter ground is sinking sand. Unless you call upon the name of the Lord, and you, when you call upon Him and believe in Him, you shall be saved. As an illustration here, we celebrate the 500th year of Reformation, and Luther was converted prior to that, but here is his testimony. I'll just read through those highlighted in here. Though I live as a monk without reproach, I felt that I was a sinner before God with an extremely disturbed conscience. Just like Nicodemus, he was a priest during that time. But in it, the righteousness of God, he was studying the book of Romans. In it, the righteousness of God is revealed, as it is written, "He through faith is righteous shall believe." Therefore, I began to understand that the righteousness of God, that which by the righteous lives by a gift of God, it is by grace, it is by faith. And here I felt I was altogether born again and had entered paradise itself through open gates. So that's our challenge for us. Examine yourself, examine the ground of your salvation. May your hope will be built on nothing less but Christ's righteousness. Now we proceed very quickly on our second point. So we have seen the inquiry of the man Nicodemus. Now we will see the imperative of the Messiah. Verse 3 said, Jesus answered to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." We have here a remarkable response to the seemingly polite inquiry of Nicodemus. It was a response of a divine imperative. Jesus, knowing what was inside the heart of Nicodemus, goes straight to the point, to the crux of the matter. You need to be born again, Nicodemus. No chit-chat, no wandering around the bush. I know all things that you have done, Nicodemus. I know your credentials, and I know that you are not safe at all. Verse 3 says, truly, truly, some translation would say, this is verily, verily, is an expression used and recorded by John to emphasize this important matter. Truly, truly, unless you are born again, Nicodemus. This is comment by Calvin. It was when he was about to speak of most important, of weighty of all subjects, he found it necessary to awaken the attention of Nicodemus. Verse 3. We continue, unless you are born again, unless you are born again, unless you are born from above. And this is Christ's imperative to him. You thought you knew everything, Nicodemus? Yeah. You thought you have obeyed every letters of the law? You thought because you are a son of Abraham, you will automatically enter into heaven? Well, breaking news for you, Nicodemus.
Yeah.
No, you have to start again. You have to have a changed heart. You have to have faith in me. You must be born again, Nicodemus. You, truly, I say to you, you must be born again. This is something, born again is something that is popular, misunderstood. It is not a religion. It is not a sect. It is not an experience. But it is the marvelous work of God by which you were made into a new creation. It is a new you with a new heart and with a new inclination to obey the Lord. It is through the power of the Holy Spirit by which our minds were illumined and we saw the depravity of our human heart and our sin and the utter worthlessness of our righteous deeds to please the Lord. And we saw that only Christ and Christ alone is the only way to the Father. Christ and His work on the cross is the only satisfying merit to appease the wrath of God. And we saw that we need to trust in Him. Nothing in my hands I bring, simply to your cross I cling. And we were changed forever.
Yeah.
And we were new creation. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 17. We were born again. That is born again, my friend. It's not experience. It's not a religion. It is this marvelous work of God in your heart by which He has changed you entirely, radically. In IT support, always the first aid and the first procedure in troubleshooting is to restart the computer. Turning on and off again. But regeneration, my friend, being born again, it's not like that. It is changing the whole computer entirely. It is changing your heart, giving you a new heart by which you love the Lord with all your heart and all your soul. And you see the need for Christ as your Savior. And that is the command for you today. It is Christ's imperative for you today that you must be born again.
Yes.
We are here to tell you how to live. The church is here not to give suggestions on daily lifestyle and living. The church here is as ambassadors are ambassadors of Christ, not to tell you how to live, but how to be alive. You must be born again. Verse 3, we continue, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Only those that are regenerated belong to the kingdom of God. You thought, Nicodemus, you are a Jew, that the Lord is your king? Again, you are mistaken. The kingdom of God is a spiritual kingdom. You can be a member of that kingdom if you were born again. If you have faith in Christ. Christ will be your king. And it's through faith, not through your words. Not of you being a Pharisee, not of you being a Jew, but faith in Christ. This expression means a spiritual kingdom which Messiah came into the world to set up and of which all believers are subject. And here a marvelous text in here, Colossians chapter 3, verse 12 to 14. The Father who has justified, who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in life, He has delivered you from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of His beloved Son. My friend, that is the kingdom of God. My point for this is this. the command from the Lord to be born again is absolutely necessary. However, this is a command that is difficult to achieve unless you put your faith in Christ alone. MacArthur comments here, he chose this one, this illustration, to make it crystal clear that new birth happens to us, not by us. We receive this birth from someone else in the same way that we receive our physical way from someone else. My challenge for us is this. Dear believers, dear Christians, dear born again people of God, you should invoke praise and doxology to God every time we are reminded of this great conversion, of what great salvation. He saved us. He brought us from the dominion of darkness into this light forever. Oh yes, or Habakkuk chapter 3 verse 18. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation. Is that you, born again Christian? Is that you, church? Are you rejoicing in the glory of the Lord that He, despite your depravity, despite your proneness to wonder, despite your inclination before to sin, and despite all the records of all those sins that you have committed against the Lord, He loved you while you were yet sinners. Christ died for us. It should evoke wonder. It should evoke amazement. It should evoke praise and joy to the God of our salvation. Genesis. The famous hymn writer, he wrote, somebody wrote this in his epitaph. John Newton, clerk, once an infidel in Libertine, a servant of slaves in Africa, was by the rich mercy of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, preserved, restored, pardoned, and appointed to preach the faith he had long labored to destroy. This is John Newton, my friend. He enslaved many people during that time. He cursed the Lord, but he saw the amazing wonder and grace of that gospel that he believed. When he was old and suffering from forgetfulness, this is what he said. My memory is nearly gone, but I remember two things. That I am a great sinner, and that Christ is. Please. Oh, church, may we have that twofold reminder in our minds always, the depravity of our sin and the glory of the gospel that we believe that was accomplished through Christ. And may we sing this song every day, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved our wretch like me. Like Nicodemus, I was lost. But now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. Church, prepare you that you abandon your self-righteousness and have faith in Christ and His grace. Let us pray.